Well, the wrestling world in shock today. Former champion Chris Benoit found dead in his Atlanta home along with his wife and young son. Police now treating the discovery as a double murder-suicide.
The Chris Benoit Files was a YouTube series produced in 2013 that examined the conspiracy theories and media coverage surrounding the Benoit family tragedy. To mark the anniversary of the deaths and the relaunch of WrestlePundit.com, here are all five episodes re-edited into a single documentary. Starting with Chapter 1, The Mysterious Wikipedia Page. More than half a day before police reported that they found the dead bodies of WWE wrestler Chris Benoit, his wife Nancy, and their young son Daniel, somebody edited the Chris Benoit Wikipedia page with the following chilling message. Chris Benoit was replaced by Johnny Nitro for the ECW Championship match at Vengeance, as Benoit was not there due to personal issues stemming from the death of his wife Nancy. And this isn't some myth or rumour. Wikipedia has a very detailed archive system of all edits that have ever taken place. As you can see on screen, somebody really did prophetically state that Nancy was dead before anyone knew. The page was edited at 12:01 AM Eastern Time Monday morning following the Vengeance pay-per-view, where Benoit was scheduled to face CM Punk and, as later revealed, was supposed to win the ECW title. The Wikipedia entry has been collected with lots of other information and used as evidence of a cover-up, that Chris was framed and the Benoit family were murdered by a third party. One thing we know for sure is that the IP address of the person who edited the page comes from Stamford, Connecticut, the same area as WWE headquarters. Did the killer work for WWE? The page editor himself took to wikinews.org to defend his actions. I just want to say it was an incredible coincidence. I'd heard about Chris Benoit no-showing Vengeance because of a family emergency, and I'd heard rumours about why that was. I was reading rumours and speculation about this matter online, and one of them included that his wife may have passed away. And I did the wrong thing by posting it on Wikipedia, despite there being no evidence. A plausible story. A diehard fan who saw Benoit was missing from the event went to read the gossip online and decided to make a wiki edit. It happens. It's since emerged that prior to the show, Chris Benoit had told WWE officials and friends that his family had food poisoning and they were at the hospital. Did a version of this make its way through the websites and forums, and this fan took the rumour a step too far? Did he just come up with a plausible reason for the no-show himself? People do vandalise Wikipedia with false information all the time. It didn't take long for police to bring the young man in for questioning and seize his computer. As reported by the Associated Press, the Wikipedia poster who flummoxed investigators by announcing the death of wrestler Chris Benoit's wife before police discovered the murder is a 19-year-old Stamford man and wrestling fan. The man, who lives with his parents on the East Side, allowed detectives to take his computer and videotape their interview with him on Friday. "He was very cooperative," said Captain Richard Conklin, head of the Detective Bureau. "He will not face charges," police said. It appears the posting was a coincidence, just as the man said Friday in an anonymous apology on Wikinews. Police found nothing to implicate the teenager. Nothing on his computer, no messages between him and Chris, people that knew Chris, or the theoretical murderer. The most obvious reason to chalk this up as a coincidence? The information he posted was not complete. He made no mention of the deaths of Chris or Daniel, and never gave an explanation about how Nancy's death occurred. Why the hell would he tell everybody on Wikipedia that Nancy had died if he'd been involved in some way? There is another person, however, who knew Chris and Nancy very, very well.
"Listen close and listen clear. You cannot stop me now."
As the world wrestled with the idea that Chris Benoit had murdered his wife and son before committing suicide, a preacher and former wrestler from Arkansas had his own more intriguing theory. Johnny Angel, the 80s journeyman, alleged that Kevin Sullivan, a cold-hearted Satanist, had carried out the gruesome murders and framed Chris to take the blame.
"I will end your way of life that you know."
Sullivan's army of darkness drew great heat in the Bible Belt of Florida, long before The Undertaker and his ministry were pushing the boundaries of primetime television. Purple Haze, The Lock, The Fallen Angel, and others were pledging their souls to the Snake Master.
"My souls, they've been taken ever since. I then realized they belong for one thing, to do the bidding for us."
The chained and beaten Fallen Angel was none other than Nancy, Chris Benoit's future wife, a young model at the time who had entered the business through the seedy apartment wrestling photography network. Before she met Chris, Nancy married Kevin Sullivan and became one of the premier female managers in pro wrestling. And according to some, the characters they portrayed in the arenas weren't that far from reality. In 1996, the couple were working in World Championship Wrestling. Sullivan had become the booker, the matchmaker and man responsible for the creative direction of the characters and storylines. In one storyline, Sullivan scripted Nancy to have an affair with Chris Benoit.
"What's it like coming home at night to an empty house, Kevin?"
Ironically, what started as scripted scenes for television soon became real. By the end of 1997, Nancy had divorced Sullivan, leaving him for the crippler. It was this, writes Johnny Angel, that gave Sullivan the motive to carry out the Benoit murders a decade later. He said a source close to him revealed that Sullivan is a high-ranking member of the Satanic Church. He says Sullivan threatened Benoit and told him he would kill him, and concludes that the police need to consider the possibility that Sullivan carried out these gruesome murders in order to have his revenge, which is what Satanists live for. Johnny Angel's theory has become quite popular on the internet. One video has a million views, and his article has been a talking point on many forums and websites. But is it really plausible? It's one thing to have an alleged motive, but what about evidence? Investigators have never treated the Benoit tragedy as suspicious. There has never been any evidence presented of another person entering the residence, and there is no eyewitness testimony or forensics linking Sullivan to the crime scene. Surely if this was a crime of passion, it would have taken place at the time of the affair, not many years later when everyone had moved on with their lives. Johnny Angel fills in this gap of logic by suggesting the 10-year span between Nancy's divorce of Sullivan and the murders is numerologically significant, though he doesn't say why. And technically speaking, the exact date of the divorce is unknown, so it's unlikely to have literally been 10 years to the day. So how significant can that really be? Claiming somebody is a Satanist based on an anonymous source and suggesting they carried out 3 brutal murders just because they were divorced once is not the kind of thing that stands up in a court of law. And outside of Hollywood and religious propaganda, Satanists don't even believe that God or the devil exists. They use Satan as a metaphor for their colourful form of atheism.
"There are a lot of misconceptions about Satanism. I mean, the first thing to say is that it's specifically a modern phenomenon. Historically, modern means post-Renaissance. So it has its roots in literature. Characters like Lord Byron, later on, let's say, the decadents like Baudelaire, created an idea which is essentially a kind of gothic militant atheism. There's a distinct difference between that and what you might term devil worship. Devil worship is the idea where you take a specific myth structure, Christianity, principally in this case, and you turn it on its head, and all of its heroes become villains and vice versa.
Je renonce à Jésus-Christ, à ses pompes et à ses œuvres, et je m'attache à Lucifer pour toujours.
Satanism's more of a lifestyle, a philosophy, it's all these different kinds of things. It's not really a belief system. Satanists, in any real sense of the word, don't believe in a literal Satan. The Satan of the Satanist is as real as things like market forces or public opinion, all these things that have a huge impact on the world but aren't really there.
If Kevin Sullivan was a member of the Satanic Church, there would be no reason for him to hide that fact. It's not a secret society. It's not illegal to be a Satanist. The Satanic Church is not a criminal or terrorist organisation. Being a Satanist has no more bearing on the Benoit case than if he was a Star Wars fan. In fact, one of their rules, as written in the Satanic Bible, is do not harm little children, which would counter the idea that he could have murdered Daniel. Other than Hulk Hogan in a sensational celeb magazine, nobody close to Nancy or Kevin have ever suggested that their characters were anything more than an entertaining gimmick.
Kevin Sullivan is a confirmed Satanist.
I don't think so. That's bullshit. How can a Catholic, Irish Catholic choir in Altamont be a Satanist? I never said I was a Satanist, and I've never been a Satanist. And again, if anybody takes this too real, it's fake! It's fake! I mean, did I ever have a problem? Yeah, I did have a problem in North Carolina, which is the Bible Belt of America, the most conservative place in the world, with Jerry Falwell, who wanted to make some publicity. Yeah. Other than that, no.
So who really is Johnny Angel, and does he have any credibility to be making these accusations? His real name is Johnny Lee Clary. Apart from having a modest wrestling career in the 80s, in which he never actually met Sullivan or Nancy, he proudly documents on his own website that he grew up in a racist household and joined the KKK as a teenager. He became one of the Klan's national figureheads and took part in sensationalist chat shows like Morton Downey Jr. and Oprah Winfrey.
May I suggest we throw their at it?
At some point along the line, he had a crisis of conscience and now preaches the word of God while sharing his story. While there will always be unanswered questions about the Benoit tragedy, it's a shame that a baseless article written by a Klansman turned religious zealot has captured so many minds. With no physical or circumstantial evidence, I think it's time we gave the old Prince of Darkness a break.
The man on the left is a former champion pro wrestler, WWE style. There are a lot of accusations and allegations about what's happened with him in domestic violence in his life. But today's accusation is this, that he shot his wife. That he shot his wife.
It is often the case with high-profile crimes that incorrect information makes its way through the media. Reporters get things wrong, investigators make early mistakes, speculation gets out of control, and people simply make things up. The Benoit family tragedy is no different. On this episode of the Chris Benoit Files, we explore four myths about the case that have no basis in reality. In a rather meandering Fox News piece with Geraldo Rivera and Bill O'Reilly, Rivera suggests there is some kind of connection between the Benoit deaths and Sherry Martel.
The authorities say that here is Chris Benoit. He kills his wife, Nancy, on Friday, June 15th, or Saturday, June 16th. Did you know that on Friday, June 15th, a woman named Sherry Martel also died of unnatural causes related to drug use? Who is Sherry Martel? She is another woman connected to this group of professional wrestlers. Indeed, the guy who was the original husband of Chris's wife, Nancy, the one he allegedly murdered, he was this other woman, Sherry Martel's booker and friend.
So they were all in there.
And she died the same day, Bill, June 15th, Friday, June 15th.
In reality, Sherry died on June 15th, and Nancy is believed to have died a whole week later on June 22nd. Sherry was found in her mother's home, and her autopsy revealed she overdosed on prescription drugs. No foul play was ever suspected. We could logically speculate that the tragic news added to any depression and tension within Nancy and Chris's relationship, since Sherry was a close friend, but there is no physical connection between the deaths. There may, however, be a connection in doctor. Sherry lived in Birmingham, Alabama, and the Benoit family home was in Fayetteville, in the neighboring state of Georgia. Following the tragedy, it emerged that Benoit's physician, Dr. Phil Astin, had been prescribing him with testosterone and other prescription drugs. In 2009, he was sentenced to 10 years in federal prison for overprescribing medications. It was noted that three of his patients died with his drugs in their system. These were Chris Benoit, ECW wrestler Johnny Grunge, whose use of painkillers clashed with his sleep apnea, causing his death in 2006, and a third undisclosed name. Dave Meltzer of the Wrestling Observer believed this to be Sherry Martel. While this sheds light on wrestling's drug issue at the time, it's not the juicy conspiracy some have suggested. The media had a field day once they discovered that Chris Benoit had been taking testosterone. His supposed obsession with steroids even stretched to injecting his son Daniel with growth hormone because he had dwarfism or was small or had Fragile X syndrome.
Benoit allegedly choked the life out of his beautiful 7-year-old son Daniel, a boy inflicted with a form of retardation called Fragile X syndrome.
Despite the media circus, Nancy Benoit's sister, Sandra, explained in a 2013 interview that none of this was true. When my sister filed for divorce, we had a legal document created that gave me custody of Daniel if anything happened to Nancy and Chris simultaneously. So when Daniel died, I was his custodian. He did not have track marks on his arms, and the district attorney made a public statement apologizing for the mistake. As his custodian, I obtained his medical records, and our lawyer, Rick Decker, made a statement to the public, the only one made, letting them know that this was 100% false information. Daniel did not have Fragile X. I have his medical records. He was not sick. One report that did the media round suggested that Chris Benoit actually murdered his son with his wrestling finishing move, the Crippler Crossface. The UK Sun said, "There was bruising consistent with the Crippler Crossface on one arm and Daniel's face. There were no bruises on his neck. Due to the boy's size, police do not think the hold was applied exactly. A chokehold was used to strangle the boy, rather than hands, because there's no bruising consistent with strangulation by hands." This report is a complete mess. First they say he used the crossface, but then he didn't because Daniel was too small. So he didn't use the crossface because it's not possible. And to suggest that he was trying to, but had to modify it, is just speculation. He either did or didn't use it. How do you know what he was thinking? It then says, "A chokehold was used to strangle the boy rather than hands, because there's no bruising consistent with strangulation by hands." What did he use, his feet? How do you use a chokehold without your hands and without harming the neck? The only facts in the report are that there was bruising to Daniel's face and arm. I would suggest that it was more likely that he was smothered, i.e. Benoit put his hands over his mouth and nose and held him down, as most other reports indicate. One persistent rumour on the internet is that Chavo Guerrero, who was in phone contact with Benoit around the time of the murders, overheard an intruder enter the Benoit residence. The article reads, Chavo told WWE magazine that he talked to Chris for a while on Friday night on his house phone. About 45 minutes into the conversation, Chris told him that there was somebody knocking at his door and he was going to see who it was. Shortly after Chris answered the door, there was a scuffle, and then his phone line went dead. Chris could only be reached on his cell phone about 3 hours later. This is very significant. This explains why there was no forced entry. Chris let the killer or killers in. There is no record of Chavo ever saying this in a WWE magazine interview. You can go back through the archives yourself at wwebackissues.com. In fact, the company made it their policy not to even mention Benoit publicly after it was determined that he was responsible. Chavo has never mentioned this so-called intruder in any other interviews either. It's just a myth. What Chavo has explained many, many times is that he had a brief phone conversation with Chris on the Saturday around the time of Nancy's death. They were both scheduled for a WWE live event.
I went my way, he went his way, and in 2.5 days, we were going to hook up again. You know, we were on the road again. So now it's Belmont, Texas, I believe. And I.
This is on like a Saturday or a Friday?
This is now Saturday morning.
Okay.
So the first one we left, might have been probably Wednesday morning.
Yeah.
So now it's Saturday morning, early. I land in Dallas, my connection, and we always get on the phone and, you know, and coordinate. What time you get in,
yeah. The
whole deal, I'll pick you up or he'll pick me up, whatever. So, I call him, no answer. Then all of a sudden, I get a call from him. And he's like, oh, call right back. Hey, Chavo, hey, what's up, man? He sounds just off. I'm like, man, you okay? He's like, yeah, I'm cool, man. Just really bad, a really, really just bad weekend. I just, you know, Daniel and Nancy are sick, his wife, you know, and, you know.
So you're actually talking to him at this point.
I'm talking to him, yeah. And
this is basically after he's probably killed his wife.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. They're sick, you know, they're not feeling good. And I'm like, all right, cool. And, well, you coming in? Yeah, I missed my flight. But don't worry, I'm going to catch another flight and I'll be there. Okay, I go, just call me when you get in and I'll pick you up, you know, no matter what time it is. You know, we were landing in Houston. I had to drive to Belmont. And I was like, you know, don't worry about it. We're late. I'll wait for you. Okay. So he gets off the phone. And he goes, he makes a point of it. It stops. He goes, Chavo. I go, yeah. And he goes, I love you. I said, I love you too, man. Wasn't too out, you know, off kilter, because mm-hmm. we always tell each other we love each other.
Yeah.
But this was really forced. It was not forced. It was really like made a point of it. It was like, hey, man, okay, I love you, brother. Okay, no, it was like, Chavo, I love you.
I want you to understand this.
Basically. Mm-hmm. Yeah, if you
don't forget this.
Coming from a man with very few words.
Yeah, yeah.
I was like, all right, I love you too, bro. So I hung up and I thought, that was strange. So I called him right back. And I go, hey, man, are you all right? I'm fine, man. Like I said, I just had a real hard weekend, you know, and just, you know, real hard weekend. And I had to go to take him, you know, Daniel and Nancy to the hospital. And I'm like, oh, okay, man. Well, I'm here. Okay, man. Okay, cool. So then hung up. And that was the last I actually talked to him. I guess he'd call Scott Armstrong, too. And he and I hooked up. Scotty, we hooked up and we ended up driving, waiting for Chris. No call. I'm calling, hey, dude, did you miss your flight? Did you make your new flight? No call, no answer. Okay, well, I guess we got to drive. Well, if we got to come back, you know, we said if we got to come back from and go pick him up, we will. So we went to the show, and, you know, the agents were asking, where's Chris?
This is a house show.
House show. Where's Chris? Chris. Next day was a pay-per-view.
Pay-per-view, yeah.
In Houston. Well, I'm like, I don't know, man. I don't know. He missed his flight. You know, he's going to, okay. So we drive to Houston the next day, me and Scotty. And
still no word.
Still no from Chris. We're calling him. Okay, nothing. I get some texts on my phone at probably 5 a.m. And I get texts from Chris.
So you wake up in the morning. You've got these
not
texts.
Even before it woke me up before 5 in the morning. Mm-hmm. So I look at my text and I'm like, that's weird. It says the dogs are in the enclosed pool area. The garage door is open. I looked at it. I was like, well, that's weird. Is this one of those texts you get? You know, sometimes you get texts, you know, from 3 days ago, you never delivered, yeah, and then all of a sudden you got a text. And this is kind of the start of texting, you know. Now it's a little different. But
yeah,
back
it was
then,
2007.
A lot of times, you know, texts didn't come through and they got lost and all of a sudden you got them. And I was like, well, that's
you get
weird.
Half a text.
Half a text, yeah, that was weird. So okay, I wrote it off. Then I get another text from Nancy's phone, from his wife's phone, and it said the same thing, you know, the same text. That's really weird. Okay, whatever. I kind of wrote it off. So then I had to get up in 2 hours, so I got up. I look at I go downstairs to meet Scotty Armstrong, and I look at him. I go, "Did you get some weird, anything weird last night happen?" And he goes, "Yeah, I got some weird texts from Chris." I said, "Me too. Did it say this?" He goes, "Yeah." So we call Chris. No answer. No answer. No answer. God, that's weird. So we go to the pay per view. Chris isn't showing up, and they're asking us, "Where's he at?" I'm not sure. We're not sure where he's at. Now we're covering for him. We
right.
think maybe you know,
blatantly lying for
yeah,
him. Now,
yeah, well, yeah, we're, you know, we're blatantly, you know, whatever. We're just covering for him. No, I haven't heard from him. I don't know what's going on. Okay, great. Didn't tell us anything about the text. Nothing.
Did that, you feel something was going on? Weird.
Something.
At this point?
Something was going on. Something was going on. And I remember Arn Anderson saying, "This is later on in the day because he was supposed to wrestle the pay per view.
He was supposed to wrestle for the title.
The ECW Championship against CM Punk." He was supposed to wrestle him, and this is a big match.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember Arn Anderson saying, "You know what? If Benoit didn't show up with no word, he's either has just taken off to like Alaska mm-hmm. and is going to be like a you know a merchant marine or something, or he's dead basically." That's and I remember him saying that, not meaning it is he's right. dead, but there's something going on for him not to show up.
And either option being just as viable, because I could see him just going off to become a merchant marine and saying,
and
screw
being
this.
Gone. Yeah, 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 and being gone, you know, basically right. the ending of Dexter.
Mm-hmm.
right? And then, so I didn't say anything. We didn't say anything. The next day, we're in Corpus Christi for a super show, another super show. And those damn super shows, man. I don't know what's got
yeah.
me.
Yeah. But and you still didn't know anything.
We still didn't know. We've been calling. So finally, I go to Johnny Ace. I go, "Johnny." Johnny was the head of talent relations.
Mm-hmm.
I go, "Johnny, this is my phone. This is what I got yesterday." And he's like, you know, with his Johnny voice, "Bravo, hey, what are you talking about? Why didn't you show me this yesterday?" I said, "Johnny, we're trying to cover for him."
Mm-hmm.
Be honest with you, I didn't know what was going on. We're covering for him. He's like, "All right, let me get on the phone." So I guess they called the Atlanta police or whatever, and I don't know anything about it. You know, that's the last thing I heard.
Well, he was scheduled for a live event in Beaumont, Texas, and it was very much unlike Chris not to make live events.
And that yet. Was on Saturday, correct?
Yes, that's right. correct. And from there, our office contacted Chris to try and rearrange flights and things of that nature so that he would come in on Sunday for the pay-per-view, and actually late that Saturday night into the pay-per-view in Texas. And that was the last we heard of him. The flight was changed, and obviously when he didn't show up on Sunday, we knew that there was something drastically wrong, because his MO was definitely to make all of his engagements. He was a consummate professional from a business standpoint, so we knew something was really wrong. His friends could not contact him. He was not answering the phone, so that's why we sent the authorities over to investigate.
But he apparently was contacting friends through text messaging.
There were two text messages to two of his friends early Sunday morning at like 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning that were very strange, hence another reason to contact the authorities. But it was things of like the side doors open,
right.
things of that nature, and the dogs are corralled in the pool. It was very strange.
A timeline of events was published on WWE's corporate website. On the Monday at 12:30 p.m., WWE was notified of the text messages that Chavo and other co-workers received. At 12:45, WWE contacted the Fayette County Sheriff's Office and requested them to go to Benoit's residence. Then at 4 p.m, WWE received a call from the County Sheriff's Office advising that they entered the house of Benoit and found three deceased bodies. They then went ahead with the tribute show, presumably before all the information was known. Do you think if Chavo, one of Benoit's closest friends, really heard an intruder, they would have kept it secret? Or if he did do this mythical WWE magazine interview, that this would be the last time we would have heard of it? Obviously, Benoit's co-workers concluded that he was acting strangely, but that does not mean there was a wider conspiracy, and none of them have expressed views of that nature. There is, however, one piece of information that has not been fully investigated, and that's the sighting of then WWE talent Dave Taylor outside the Benoit residence shortly before the police arrived. Benoit's neighbour Holly was the first port of call after WWE had contacted the authorities and they decided to investigate. She was instructed by police to enter the property before they got there to secure the dogs that were running around the yard and check on the Benoits to see what was going on. To her shock, she discovered the bodies, and upon fleeing the house, she claims to have seen Dave Taylor and his wife Lisa carrying a platter of deli food towards the house. Of course, this certainly doesn't mean Dave Taylor was in any way involved in the murders. Having heard the family had been sick, and his friend no-showed some events, it's likely he was just checking up on them and making sure there was some food in and everything was going well. In his book Chris and Nancy, wrestling critic Irv Mushnick was a bit more cynical, suggesting Taylor may have been sent by WWE to lurk around and get certain facts early to prevent a PR problem. During the tribute show, William Regal appeared like he may have known something early.
You know, it was interesting because I remember Regal on that tribute. He was the one guy that kind of, he wasn't gushing. Like, remember, everyone else was like, Chris was the best and yeah. So much respect. And Regal was like, well, you know, he was a great performer in the ring and whatever happened, happened. There was some kind of weird thing there. He knew something had gone wrong that yeah. night. And maybe because he lived in Peachtree City in Atlanta with Chris, but...
It's possible that some people in WWE got wind that this was some kind of murder scenario, but went ahead with the tribute show anyway. That's the only conspiracy.
And welcome back to Hannity and Combs. Critics are taking the WWE to task over Chris Benoit's tragedy. Some say steroid abuse is rampant at the organization.
What role steroids played in the Benoit murder-suicide? The tragedy has made clear both how pervasive roids are in wrestling and how easy it is to obtain them.
The mainstream media had somewhat of a field day with the idea that Chris Benoit murdered his family in a fit of roid rage. They invited on wrestlers to interrogate them on their own steroid use, and ran with the false information that Benoit may have even been juicing little Daniel.
Let's assume for a moment that he had taken some steroids. Let me ask you, have you taken steroids ever?
Let's talk about this issue of steroids and roid rage. Did your understanding that, is this an issue, and have you seen this as a pattern among professional wrestlers?
The roid rage theory is problematic for a number of reasons, not least because medical experts still debate about whether the phenomenon even exists, or if it does exist, that it's solely down to steroids and not pre-existing mental disorders or a negative effect of combining steroids with other substances. There is no reliable scientific data on the matter.
When you talk about roid rage for me is a pie-in-the-sky theory that's thought up by people that have no business discussing the frame of mind of elite physical athletes.
But that's not
athlete.
The point. Look, I understand your desire to be number
no,
one in your
field.
No,
the point
is
you're trying to say overall that taking steroids is bad, and I don't think it is.
In research published by the President's Council on Physical Fitness and Sports, it's concluded that anticipation of the aggressiveness related to steroid use may lead to actual violent acts and become, in effect, an excuse for aggression. They did not believe that there is a causal relationship between roid rage and steroids. Accounts of what was found in Benoit's home are also sketchy because the investigators and media often use the catch-all term of steroids rather than the actual substance listed on the packaging. Steroids are not all one thing, and their individual effects vary. Also, regardless of what was or wasn't discovered in the home, testosterone was the only steroid actually present in his body, according to toxicology, which means it's the only substance that can even be considered in a roid rage theory. Growth hormone, for example, is not a precursor to a rise in testosterone. Although testosterone was found in Chris Benoit's urine, there is no evidence of any other of the illegal types of steroids, or the whole laundry list of anabolic steroids that are out there to be used, said the medical examiner. The presence of testosterone alone even could be an indicator that he was being treated for testicular insufficiency. Many older men, particularly those that have abused steroids in the past, go through testosterone replacement therapy because their body can no longer produce adequate amounts naturally. So, could the testosterone in Benoit's system have caused roid rage? Not necessarily. While it's long been believed that testosterone causes male aggression, modern studies show that on its own, elevated levels are not actually conducive to aggression. Supraphysiological doses of testosterone, when administered to normal men in a controlled setting, do not increase angry behaviour, concludes a 1996 paper. In fact, some data suggests it is those low in testosterone that exhibit anger and aggression, and replacement therapy restores the balance. When the men were given testosterone replacement therapy and were asked to complete questionnaires about their mood several times over the course of 2 months, their general sense of well-being improved markedly. Their anger and agitation decreased, their sense of optimism and friendliness heightened, reported the New York Times. Recent studies even suggest elevated testosterone levels can result in better thought out and fairer decisions, rather than rash and risky behaviour as previously assumed. New scientific evidence refutes the preconception that testosterone causes aggressive, egocentric and risky behaviour. A study at the universities of Zurich and Royal Holloway, London, with more than 120 experimental subjects, has shown that the sexual hormone with the poor reputation can encourage fair behaviours if this serves to ensure one's own status, reported Science Daily in 2009. The overall picture is inconclusive, and there are too many variables to categorically claim roids equal rage without taking into account other factors. The medical examiner at the time of the Benoit tragedy concluded that essentially, I think it's an unanswerable question. In other words, there is no evidence that Chris Benoit had roid rage, whatever that even means. Interestingly, WWE claimed he was clean of both anabolic steroids and testosterone when tested in the April, and toxicology suggests he'd only taken testosterone recently before the tragedy. There is some evidence that actually coming off steroids may cause depression and mood problems. With the newly implemented wellness policy, it's possible Benoit was on the least amount of steroids that he's been on in years. That could just as easily have played a role than roid rage. It simply doesn't hold up to scrutiny. The crime took place over 3 days. Nancy was bound, Daniel was sedated, and Bibles were placed next to their bodies. This demonstrates Chris was in a deranged and depressive state, but with the ability to plan and premeditate. A note was later discovered which read, "I'm preparing to leave this earth," the key word being preparing. This was clearly not a burst of rage, but a deeper psychological problem. Toxicology also found that Benoit's system contained a combination of Xanax, a powerful psychoactive anti-anxiety and depression drug, and hydrocodone, an addictive semi-synthetic opioid-derived painkiller that bears relation to heroin. Side effects of Xanax include a loss of inhibitions, memory and concentration problems, drowsiness, and in some people, aggression, rage, mania, suicidal thoughts, and hallucinations. As weird as it sounds, a very common effect of anti-anxiety and depression medication is more anxiety and depression.
The more you take it, the more the brain's fighting back, and the more you're creating anxiety. So in the studies that we used for FDA approval for Xanax, by 8 weeks, the patients were worse. They were in serious withdrawal. Up to a third of them couldn't even get off the drug. After 8 weeks, they couldn't get off the drug.
Side effects of hydrocodone can also include changes in mood and anxiety. Empty bottles also suggest alcohol may have been a factor, though we can't say for sure because it would have already left the bodies before toxicology was performed.
The thing that I'm really curious of is,
you know, alcohol was found on the scene. They said earlier that alcohol was found on the scene. And I guess that's just not sexy enough for the media. Here's a person that has had a DUI, who has had problems with alcohol before. And if you look in your federal penitentiaries, I'm sure there's a lot more people causing violent crime on alcohol than on steroids.
The focus.
There is a wide range of possible factors that played a role in determining Benoit's mental state. Roid rage is only one of them, and it's not supported by the evidence.
Chris Benoit, the wrestler, was an enormous public success with a career spanning decades. He was one of the most popular performers of his generation. To those who knew him privately, Chris Benoit also appeared to be a devoted family man.
He was a very kind, what you saw in the ring was not the Chris Benoit on the outside. He loved to be at home playing with his children. That's where he wanted to be.
So when Chris's father, Michael, first learned of his son's death, the gruesome details made no sense.
He phoned me on Father's Day, which was a week before. And I said, you know, how are you going? What are you doing? And he said, unfortunately, Dad, I'm on the road. It's Father's Day today. I wish I was home with my family. So a week later, we end up with this tragedy.
Behind those closed doors this June, Chris Benoit did the unthinkable.
The wife was bound on her feet and I think also on her wrists.
Over 3 days, he strangled his wife, suffocated his 7-year-old son, then killed himself.
Are you shocked to this day of specifically what happened?
Absolutely. Absolutely. We would have never dreamt that Chris was capable of doing this.
Plagued by grief and unanswered questions, Michael Benoit received a surprising phone call.
Chris Benoit!
It was 4 days after the tragedy that Chris Nowinski of the Sports Legacy Institute contacted me.
I told him I think there was something worth investigating. I thought brain injuries may have played a role in what happened, and it was worth doing the studies.
While we may never know exactly all of the factors that caused the Benoit family tragedy, we now do know what contributed to Chris's poor mental state, and it wasn't roid rage. Tests carried out on Benoit's deceased brain conclude that he had a form of severe brain damage at the time of his death. Julian Bales, the head of neurosurgery at West Virginia University, summarized that this was comparable to an 85-year-old Alzheimer's patient. This could not have been from steroid abuse. The results revealed chronic traumatic encephalopathy, CTE, in all four main regions of Benoit's brain. CTE is caused by repeated trauma to the head.
Yeah, look at this. It'll be a gorilla press.
The disease expresses itself in memory problems, depression, aggression, erratic and abnormal behavior, and is believed to contribute to cases of suicide. Andrew Test Martin, who overdosed on prescription pills in 2009, also had CTE. Among wrestling circles, it is often suggested that no other athletic profession shows the same rate of premature death. However, the NFL is not too far behind. More than 20 deceased American football players have been diagnosed with CTE, many who died early, committed suicide, or acted abnormally in their latter years. Pittsburgh Steelers offensive lineman Justin Strelzik led police on a 40-mile high-speed chase through central New York at speeds of up to 100 miles per hour on the wrong side of the highway. This resulted in an explosive crash and his death at just 36 years old. At the time, he had been telling relatives he was hearing voices from the evil ones. It just so happens, he also had CTE. The issue is now so widely known in football circles that when former Chicago Bear Dave Jurison killed himself by gunshot to the chest in 2011, he left a suicide note requesting his brain be examined like many of his predecessors. The underlying factor between all those diagnosed with CTE is that they had a history of concussions, not just one or two, but where it was a regular result of their activity. These concussions were often overlooked and untreated. Suplexes, flying headbutts, and unprotected chair shots to the front and back of the head were all commonplace in the rabid Wolverine's stiff matches. He also displayed a number of strange behaviours prior to the tragedy that could be attributed to CTE, including depression, aggression in the marriage, and paranoia. He took different routes to the airport, worried he was being followed. Nancy Benoit's sister says that he would also find 30 different routes to drive to the gym so his movements couldn't be monitored. A paper produced by those who studied Benoit's brain makes note of a diary which included numerous references to depression and to memory lapses. It's plain that he was depressed. It's plain that he was beginning to exhibit some of the signs of the dementia that's associated with the brain injuries he sustained, because he talks in there about not being able to remember things, Benoit's father's lawyer would tell an Atlanta News affiliate. The tests on Benoit's brain were overseen by independent research foundation, the Sports Legacy Institute, whose president is former WWE wrestler and Harvard sociology graduate Chris Nowinski. The Tough Enough reality show contestant, who debuted as the arrogant Harvard Chris character on TV in 2002, didn't even have a full year on the main roster before he retired due to post-concussion symptoms. Unlike Nowinski, Benoit was of an old-school mentality that considered working hurt a badge of honor.
Yeah, I took my share of brain trauma over the years. It started probably with soccer when I played kindergarten through eighth grade, and then I transitioned over to football. So I played both ways in high school, never left the field, and then was all-Ivy defensive tackle at Harvard University. Never had a diagnosed concussion in my entire soccer or football career, although now I know I had them, I just never thought twice about them. Finally, that caught up to me when I became a pro wrestler with WWE, which I did for about 3 years, about a little over a year on Monday Night Raw. And I had to stop from a concussion I got in June 2003, where I got kicked in the head and immediately was confused, forgot where I was, what we were doing. We got through the end of the match, but I had a headache that just wouldn't go away. And unfortunately, I didn't realize that that was a big deal. I thought, there are guys out here wrestling with torn ACLs and fused necks and all sorts of pain. And all I had was this kind of throbbing headache and a little nausea when I got my heart rate up. And I thought, that feels like the flu. And I've wrestled with the flu before, so why can't I wrestle with this? And so I kept lying about how bad I was and wrestling for 5 weeks. It only stopped when, out of the blue, I developed sleepwalking and injured myself, acting out a dream and jumped off a bed through a nightstand in a hotel. And only then, when I woke up on the ground, like having no idea how I got here, that's when I realized that I'd probably done something to my brain that I should be honest and get it checked out. And by that time, all the additional injury on top of the undiagnosed concussion had damaged my brain so much that I ended up with 5 years of post-concussion syndrome. Had headaches. The sleepwalking lasted for 3.5 years, so I had to be sedated every night. I mean, mid-20s were rough, and I've gotten better now, but I'm still permanently damaged. I can tell. And the concern now is, will I develop this disease, or do I have this disease, chronic traumatic encephalopathy, a degenerative brain disease we're finding in the brains of former athletes that we used to call punch drunk, which means that right now my brain's rotting away.
The reason that I was really wanted to look into this case was because Chris had told me that, we talked about our concussion histories, that he had more than he could count.
So far, his Sports Legacy Institute has studied the brains of four former NFL players who committed suicide. They say they found brains so damaged from multiple concussions, they resembled those of Alzheimer's patients. They believe the brain damage and the resulting dementia may be an important factor in the suicides and possibly even homicide.
The problem here, and sort of the lesson here, is that I don't think any of us prior to very recently have realized that concussions can affect your brain in such a drastic way at such a young age.
With this new information, Benoit's family agreed to allow scientists to study Chris's brain.
When we did an examination on his brain, what we found was very similar to what we found in four previous NFL players.
That's a different
type. Dr. Julian Bales examined Chris Benoit's brain using a protein stain that highlights areas of trauma. It is evidence, Bales says, of a condition called CTE, chronic traumatic encephalopathy.
As far as you know, it was the concussion to the brain that created this damage?
It was multiple traumatic injuries, yes.
After the toxicology report found steroids in Benoit's system, speculation began that roid rage might have been behind what happened that fateful weekend.
There's no consensus in the medical community that this issue of roid rage, uncontrolled violence, precipitated by seemingly normal life stressors, there's no consensus that that even exist. The changes that we see in his brain tissue are not caused by steroids. There's no medical evidence or research that's ever shown that anabolic steroids cause those dead neurons. Some people would even say that steroids are good for the brain, that they support the brain. They don't destroy it.
Everyone is pointing to steroids and drug abuse. It's my feeling now that it's much more than that, that it's brain injury that has been causing these problems in the wrestling community.
Perhaps the reason why there are so many theories about the Benoit family tragedy is that the possible reasons behind what Chris did are not easy to understand and are somewhat open to interpretation. While the rational among us can discount baseless accusations like Kevin Sullivan the Satanist did it, when we get into the minutiae of toxicology, steroid studies, drug effects, and CTE, things get more complicated. There isn't a simple answer to help us sleep at night. For the sake of scientific integrity, what we cannot do is use emotional cop-outs like, oh, he was evil, and leave it at that. Likewise, attributing hate and anger towards an irrational act like the Benoit tragedy is itself irrational. After all, the fact that he did these horrific things should make it obvious that he was in a defective mental state. You and I can't possibly comprehend why he did what he did, because we're not operating in his reality. The whole point is to understand what caused that mental state. I think it's highly unlikely that Chris Benoit woke up one morning and simply decided that over the next few days he was going to kill his family and himself. Years of untreated concussions clearly impacted his cognitive function. This poor mental state was possibly compounded by long-term steroid abuse and short-term prescription drug use, as well as maybe alcohol. If you factor in a highly stressed work and family environment, such as WWE's grueling schedule, and the turmoil in his marriage, the responsibility of a young child, and his constant state of bereavement at the loss of his close friends, the tragedy becomes less of a shock. We're never going to know exactly all of the factors that played a role, but Benoit wasn't evil, he was broken. His final actions were the results of a diseased mind in an environment that wasn't conducive to recovery. Thankfully, unlike the concept of evil, mind and environment are very real things that can be altered for the better. That's why WWE's implementation of concussion monitoring and drug testing is such a positive move, as is the limiting of more dangerous in-ring maneuvers like unprotected chair shots to the head, and the offering of free rehab for all current and former contracted talent. As fans, we may lust for a more violent style of wrestling, but is it really worth it at the detriment of the performer's long-term health? As much as people like to blame Vince McMahon for treating his circus animals poorly, we encouraged him by paying for his show. Now he's doing the right thing, we need to embrace it. Although the company have kept Chris Nowinski at arm's length, never publicly accepting their role in the destruction of Benoit's brain, 2013 marked a major turning point in their relationship. WWE donated $1.2 million to the Sports Legacy Institute to fund further research into CTE. In the October, they received the organization's Impact Award for their commitment to solving the concussion epidemic. The sheer amount of wrestlers that have been taken out of the ring in the past year due to concussions is as good a sign as any that they're now taking things seriously. Although the Benoit tragedy was one of the darkest times in wrestling history, it's also given us the opportunity to save lives in the future. Thanks for watching the Chris Benoit Files. I've been the wrestling pundit, Keelan Balderson, and I'll be back soon with more videos exploring the fascinating world of pro wrestling.